the final speaker of the panel, and a very special, very unique person indeed, Fiamma Nirenstein, is not only a columnist, an author, a journalist, who's produced over 12 books and hundreds of articles. She's a former member of the Italian Parliament. She has served on some of the most difficult assignments and commissions in the Italian Parliament. She regularly writes for the Italian newspaper Il Giornale, for other newspapers, and she's been awarded over 20 international awards for her literary and journalistic activities, including an award by the Israeli Knesset, which she received in 2009 for her efforts in fighting anti-Semitism. I think very few people in Europe understand the real depth of anti-Semitism is in Europe, as Fiamma does. And we're very fortunate to have you today, Fiamma. Thank you.
BESA humbles me, the BESA Institute, and the Fiamma in particular. I thank him particularly for two reasons. One, the BESA is one of the groups that produces the writing that I've been mostly copying. You know, I've been copying all of your, and because I really love what you have elaborated and what you write. And the second reason is that the una riscioncia lì che citizen, che ezrachi israeli, as a zebemet bishulima shumeot kishu. Well, I have, of course, to speak about Europe, and I will start from Obama. So, because in the last days, I wondered very much about the bizarre choice of Obama at the UN to put on the same level as the two major problems about the stability in the Middle East, the perspective of an Iranian atomic bomb on one side and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I ask myself, how comes that he sees as the two most important problems the perspective of an atomic Islamic mushrooms and the Israeli issue at this moment where terrorist slaughters make thousands of victims every day. In the Middle East, the civilians and children are killed by a thousand. The Sunni Shiite milchama, it's a real milchama, is taking place all over the Middle East. And the Muslim persecution against the Christians should bother him particularly. But it seems that the Israeli-Palestinian conflicts bothers him more, and at the same level as Iran. So I really thought for several days about it. And the only thing that really came up to my mind, that something that explained it, how it happened, is Mrs. Ashton, the foreign affairs minister of the European Union. After, you remember probably that after the terrorist attack in Toulouse in 2012, she compared the Jewish children killed there to the children in Gaza. I remember that, unintendedly and incidentally killed during a war. And who knows if they were used as human shield, which is quite possible and probable. I thought of her extremely worried attitude when she, during the worst slaughters of Assad in the period of these incredibly bloody earthquakes, also in Egypt, she mostly raised her voice to speak about a hunger strike of one prisoner in an Israeli jail. And now when the UA came up with its very radical guidelines, including also surprisingly, is Jerusalem and the Golan Heights as areas that must be eradicated from the Israeli borders. Just like, you know, that was really ridiculous at the normal and rational mind. The misconception that guides the American description of the major problem and the position of the European Union nowadays are very similar. And for the first time in the history of the world, they are also, both of them, strongly influenced by a wide presence of the Islamic culture and the incitement continuously coming either from outside and from inside the Western world borders where great community of immigrants live. The EU history of suspicion and hate against the Jews has found a completely new turn with globalization. We have nowadays a globalized point of view that never existed before. America was the defender of Israel. Even when there was, it doesn't matter if it was right or left, Clinton was a defender of Israel. You can put it the way the way you like. But at the end of the day, he would defend Israel. He repeated it many, many times. So now we know that old Europe is no more alone in its bad relationships with Israel. Globalism has diffused a total misconception whenever we deal with the public opinion about Israel and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. So it is. And this misconception has been nourished all over this year, from Chomsky to Saramago. So we have a full and complete chain of intellectuals and of NGO, as you have said, and of human rights committee, and all the UN members and organizations. You think about the UNESCO, which has already been quoted today, that not to lose the habit, just in this day, combined six new condemned against Israel, six altogether, just only because Israel pretends that his ancient, most important cultural relation with the land where it is are just its own cultural and religious heritage. But this is condemned. This is widely condemned. Now let's focus on Europe. I'm sorry to bring you bad news about union, because you know we try to tell the truth about the history of Israel and the history of the Middle East. Nobody cares about it. You know, nobody wants to know about the continuous refusal of the Arab world to the mere existence of the State of Israel. When they put down there the peace process, the problem of the territories, they put it in a completely different way. There is an enormous wide range of causes for this let's blame Israel first attitude. And they are all very, very serious and deep. And it's about time that we take this into consideration. Because we have thought that explaining it to them or trying to appease them, saying, yes, you are almost right, not completely, but we can understand why you blame us for the wall, which is not even a wall, or for the checkpoints, or for all. Yes, we are so sorry about the things that you are accusing us for. You know, this continuous attempt to appease the international public opinion, almost embracing it. It's a total mistake for a basic reason, that the reason for this European refusal are total. You know what is total? They are total. I will tell you why. The EU make a virtue of being post-nationalist and secular, while Israel is based on a territorial definition of the Jews, also for the non-religious portion of the population. Unity and identity, the opposite of the European Union, are basic values for Israel, exactly the opposite of Europe. And concepts as self-defense, national religion, and traditional culture are the opposite of Europe's willingness to create a society built on multiculturalism, religious and ethnic differences, universalism. Moreover, Israel is obliged to, by its theological position, to defend itself through weapons, wars, various means of self-defense, has an army that is the backbone of the nation. And this is unbearable to the European. While I was listening to the extremely interesting panel that took place before us, if you try to offer it to an European Union, they would think that we are crazy. I was trying to listen to it also with European ears, and add to this the ponderous injection of the Palestinian third worldist narrative, which so much fits the sense of guilt of the European toward the third world, and nowadays is also very close to the new American Obamian vision of the globe. The result is a complete ignorance and a diffuse suspicion and the basic absence of the Palestinian narrative. You know, the narrative, Abu Mazen said that the UN, that the Jewish deprived the original people, the aboriginal people, as they defined themselves from time to time. they are widely believed to be the Aborigines here, not the Jews. We should repeat it all the time. We are the Aborigine people, because this is a concept that has not passed at all, and we never repeat it. Why? Because we are afraid to offend the Palestinians when we say that. So when I say we, I can quietly refer to the Israeli. The Israeli don't want to repeat it too much. So the Abu Mazen said that their land, that the Palestinians they were deprived by the Jews by their land with the Nakba of 1948, which is a lie. That they lost a sweet and rich environment. He repeated it now at the UN. I don't know if you heard this speech. That they lost their hometowns. That at the beginning of the 20th century there was a national movement. That this land were populated by a developed society, where culture flourished and people were ruled by and organized state based on social justice and respect for human rights. Now, you understand? So the Jews, according to this narrative, have destroyed and are continuing to do that, this ideal society, sort of Rousseau society, Rousseauian society, in the past and in the future, and put the Middle East, for their own sake, in a continuous state of war and of oppression of one people over another. You must believe it. Even our best friend, and we have friends, do not really believe that the Jews have a birthright to Israel. Some things that they write to Israel are there, but either they stem from the Shoah or they stem from the fact that they made the desert flower, or they stem from the Shoah that this is the only democracy in the Middle East. But nobody really thinks that our right to this land comes from the fact that this land has been 2,000 years ago, the land of the Jewish people, and that since then, for instance, you tell the people that in the 18th century, Jerusalem had already a majority of Jews. Nobody knows that. The Jews have always been here, that have never left Jerusalem or other towns and places. Nobody knows that. So if you think about the issue of the territories, this document particularly express an irrational animosity. Israel in 1967 has militarily occupied territories of one of the state aggressors, Jordan. And this is the truth. But instead of considering this basic historical fact, the world blames the Jews as having a greedy desire of power. Moreover, with the guidelines, Europe defines those borders that are supposed to be agreed upon during the negotiation. It draws the lines of sanction on whatever is produced beyond the Green Line, including Jerusalem. And all this happens in Europe while the two parts, the Palestinians and the Israeli, are finally sitting, which is just the thing that Europe says that mostly desires. And there is an incredible contradiction in that. So what is the reason for that? The reason is that Europe thinks that at the end of the day, Israel must surrender. Surrender. And when I say surrender, I mean it must give up territories, must shrink. Kama sheyoter katan, kama sheyoter tov. This is the idea. This is the idea that is. Gamem sovlim, aval midvarim acherim. Ochlim yoter midai, l'mashal kulam mishmenim. So, okay. So I want to go to my proposals. They are not only proposals, they are my experience. I've been for 5 years the deputy president of the Commission of the Foreign Affairs of the Italian Parliament. I have finished with that just 3 months ago, 4 months ago, and then I made my Aliyah. And we have done an enormous quantity of work where we succeeded in putting people together to defend Israel. Huge numbers and very important people, and it has been a hard work, but the work is possible if you don't try to convince Europe. You must not try to convince Europe. You have to do several things. First of all, you must be sincere. I want to tell you something. We have been working for 2 years in the putting up a commission about anti-Semitism that has been working on a bipartisan basis. And then we have conclusions that are also in English and are a book like this. After tens of hearings. Now, do you think that we tried to appease the public opinion, saying, for instance, that we are against anti-Semitism, but also against Islamophobia, or that this is only on the right side of the political spectrum, that it is a Nazi fascist heritage? No, we didn't do anything like that. We really mentioned all the things that are true. We went straight, looking into the eyes of everybody, and we convinced them. You know that when you take an issue and you don't, there have been many situations where we have done that about anti-Semitism. And I want to go very quick, but give me all 4 minutes more, okay?
Two.
No, three. No, the Italians are just like this, don't worry. About anti-Semitism, Israel must be much more active. It's a personal offense that there is so much anti-Semitism in Europe. Eh? It's a personal offense. Why don't you get it that 36 on 100 European have been anti-Semitically arrested in this last year? Israel must send delegation everywhere where this rests, must be aggressive, must go to Greece. We have gone to Hungary with a group of parliamentarians, and we fought for them. The Israeli must always be there. When the police in France refuse to check the street of the anti-Semitic origin of the killing of Ilan Halimi and say that the reasons were different, Israel should have sued France because it was a lie. It was an anti-Semitic murder. Okay, now I want to tell you one more thing. We have to choose groups that are islands of sympathy. I call them islands of sympathy, and they exist. You know about the Christians for the Jews, but this is an American phenomenon. In Europe, we don't have that. I know, the first thing is that you have to deal with Europe. You don't forget Europe. You always are turned toward America. I understand that because it's more favorable. But, you know, Europe is very near. It's very important and has a continuous contact with the Arab world. So Europe has to be dealt with. Now, these islands of sympathy are the business community, the scientific community, the high-tech community, the army community, the security community, and then the moral. Did you get what I mean? I had to make it very short. There was a description of every single phenomenon about that, but if you will have questions, I will answer to that. Because each of these part of the society have special reason to be interested in Israel and to understand how good and how important Israel is. And then there is another community, which is the moral community. The moral community. You said several times here that Europe is a dying continent. This is what it is. It's a dying continent. And longs for an ideal, longs for seeing the youngsters getting together and singing and loving each other and helping and saving each other in situations of dangers. When they long for this, they long for an ideal being shalem, to be an entire person. It's something that doesn't exist anymore in Europe. And there are also other reasons. For instance, Israel is really democratic. The homosexual community is very happy about being Israeli. And the Italian homosexuals are very pro-Israeli. And there are other communities. For instance, the community of the people that deal about immigration admire Israel because the methods of immigrations and of come si dice, of mingling people together, of Israel are special, you can learn a lot from that, and so on and so forth. So I think we have to focus, last thing, don't think that Europe will help Israel if there is an Iranian problem. To raise the European, Europe don't believe in the atomic bomb, punto, ho finito. Europe don't believe in the Italian in the bomb, because their bomb is not part of their panorama. They see a beautiful panorama. How can there be an atomic bomb so close and so dangerous and so? They will be quieted down by some. So there is one only way: using the issue of human rights. Human rights are the important thing for Europe, even they don't really care very much, but they pretend to. So when you go there and you say that women are persecuted and homosexuals are hanged, and that forms a public opinion. I know that I brought a lot of resolution about Iran. We discussed Iran almost every day in the Italian parliament. But when I took the fiancé of Neda, the girl that was killed in the street, for a hearing in the parliament, well, that was the real thing that raised the attention. So there are many methods to that. What we have to do is to be specific and not to pretend to conquer the heart of mind, the European. This is far for us and it's almost dead.